Dear students, this is Dr. Madhu Kamra with a video lecture on Matthew Arnold's A Study of Poetry. Now, before we begin with the essay, let me tell you something about Matthew Arnold. You all know that Matthew Arnold was a very popular Victorian poet, and study of this essay, you would also come to know that he was a formidable critic too. Matthew Arnold was the first one to establish practical criticism. He was the first one to propound it, and later you'll find that it was well developed by I.A. Richards. He was also a moralist, because to him, moral ideas in a poetry was very essential. He was also a classicist, and he asserted that classical values are very essential in order to make a text rich in theme, character and style. Matthew Arnold was the one who also influenced writers like T.S. Eliot, F.R. Lewis, George Saintsbury and many more. And you also find that his essay Study of Poetry was well appreciated by T.S. Eliot, and he counted it as a classic in English criticism. This essay first appeared in the year 1888 in the volume which was prepared by T.H. Watts by the title The English Poets. And here you will find that Arnold wrote with an intent to criticize the art of poetry as well as the art of criticism. Now, coming to what does he mean by great poetry? When he talks about study of poetry, this essay was written in the year 1888. Let me first tell you what exactly is great poetry. Great poetry is a representation of ideas which are meaningful for a healthy and fruitful living. It is also the application of values and ideas necessary for the criticism of life. You also find that it is the breadth and finest spirit of knowledge, and also amounts to high seriousness. Now, this element of high seriousness is illustrated by Arnold with the help of excerpts from poems of legendary poets, eminent poets like Dante, Shakespeare and Milton. So, great poetry is the work of the acknowledged masters. Now, poetry is defined by Matthew Arnold towards the start of the essay. He says that poetry is eternal. It does not die. It lives for ages. And at the same time, it has a more lasting value than any other human institution. And he says that poetry is essential for the accomplishment of all that which is needed to make our existence and refinement more meaningful. He says that poetry is of perennial value, and it is a position which contributes to our joy and inspiration. He also adds that poetry is superior to history, philosophy, science, and even religion. Now, he also adds that it is poetry which purifies our wit and strengthens our judgment. So, poetry is needed in order to elevate man to the highest possible degree. Talking about how to judge a poem, Matthew Arnold talks about two fallacies in a way that it stands a caution to all readers, and he names it as historic estimate and personal estimate. Now let us see what is historic estimate. Historic estimate is the pull of antiquity. when you believe that the past ancestors or our masters have done something wonderful, and the same can be located in the present writings. So he says this is something which needs to be on check. Then he says that one who is prone to this fallacy reflects conventional admiration and indulges more in feeling than in enjoying a work of poetry as possible. And then he says that in order to avoid this, one should keep a check on one's feel of veneration. Only then he will develop a critical eye to discern what is real accomplishment on the part of a poet or an author. Now coming to the personal estimate, he says that personal affirmities should be kept at bay while judging a text, and what is important is personal circumstances leading you into the estimation of a poet. So if you keep a check on personal estimation as well as personal circumstances, then you would avoid enthusiastic criticism and would make an honest and appropriate judgment of the text. Here you find that he gives an example of Gray and says, the poet Gray, and says that he is singular in his poetic sensibility and style, even though his output was scanty. But yet you'll find that because he was well read in Greek literature, that shaped his wit, and therefore you'll find that his contribution to literature, English poetry, is therefore recognizable in quality if not in quantity. Coming to the next point, Matthew Arnold says that high seriousness is the hallmark of great poetry. Now let me tell you what is high seriousness. High seriousness is elemental of high truth. It is a blend of Aristotle's mighty thoughts and Longinus's sublimity. When the two blend, you have excellent matter and grand style. He also says that high seriousness makes you treat a subject with a simplicity, but at the same time focuses on bringing out what is new and at the same time what is lofty in content and joyous in feel. Then the next point that we have is what is important in Arnold's criticism in the study of poetry is the touchstone method. Now students, let me tell you what is touchstone method. This makes an integral and vital part of the essay understudy, and it is all about a tool or a method which was developed by Matthew Arnold to distinguish poetry of a high order of excellence. Now, it is this tool which makes you measure virtues, quality, and reflective substance that makes a poem rich in all countable ways. Then, this touchstone method was the first tool to bring in comparative method of criticism, which was also followed later by a very eminent new critic, that is Ellen Tate, when he talks about his own tool by the title Tension. And here in this tool, Matthew Arnold estimates a poet by placing a text beside the known classics of the world. Commonly, those classics are borrowings from ancient Greek, Roman, as well as British authors. Now, of the British poets, you'll find Shakespeare, Spencer, and Milton are also included as models, and this mode of criticism helps in understanding the quality of a literary text, whereby it saves a reader from falling prey to two of the fallacies which I've already named, that is the historical estimate and the personal estimate, and it also gives you a concrete way of making a judgment and evaluation of a text. Now, keeping this in mind, you realize the worth of the great masters, and at the same time, you can also estimate what makes poetry perennial and at the same time everlasting in its joy and learning. Now, this touchstone method was very well received by eminent writers of English also. For example, T.S. Eliot praised Arnold's objective approach to critical evaluation, particularly his tools of comparison and analysis. Whereas Ellen Tate, as I earlier mentioned in his essay, Tension in Poetry, following Arnold's touchstone method, coined the term tension as a tool to evaluate poetry, and by the use of tension, he alludes to proper balance between connotation and denotation in poetry, that is the apparent meaning and the hidden meaning in poetry. Thank you so much for listening to me, and I hope that this essay is now clear to you. Thank you.